started. How's that?
Better.
All right, good.
I found out yesterday that the mic is in all angles, so I had it upside down because it fit better. I said, gee, I can't hear you, you know? There we go, there's the bell. And we're off. Well, it's nice to see so many people who came back. You never know, you know, you just never know. Well, let's begin with a prayer then, okay? In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Father, we thank you for this opportunity to come together and to reflect on the teaching of your Son. And we ask you to help us as we continue our Lenten journey to open ourselves more completely to the compelling power of your word and to trust in your guidance and the guidance of the Spirit. We raise this prayer in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Well, what I thought I would do to begin with tonight would be just to take a little bit of time, because we weren't here last week, to kind of do a little bit of a review. And then what I want to do is I want to do a group of parables that it's kind of a subset. They're called exemplary stories. They're found in Luke's Gospel. And then there are several parables that I'm going to hopefully get to tonight, which deal with prayer and the way in which we pray. Just very, very briefly, remember the first night we came together and talked a little bit about parables. And I explained that basically they are comparisons. Jesus and other teachers use them, a comparison that was made between something that people would know in order to open up to them something they were not aware of. And so we find Jesus making comparisons between, as we saw 2 weeks ago, things that would be well known just from normal life. For example, the sowing of a mustard seed. There was no story in that parable. It was just basically drawing attention to what everybody knew happened. You put the seed in the ground, it grows up into a big shrub. That's it. There was no story about that we would find in other parables. Other times, Jesus would tell a story, and those stories would again, sometimes explicitly, make a reference to the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven in Matthew's gospel, and the whole story. It is the kingdom of God. It is like this king, for example, or the sower went out to sow, or what happened. Actually, there isn't an explicit comparison there. That's one that's implied. But there's a comparison that is made. The idea being to open up to those who would be listening, something of the action of God, something of the kingdom of God, what would be expected of those who believed, what indeed were to live. Basically, there were two types of parable. The one would be, as I said, something from nature, natural life. The mustard seed was one example. The other example was the seed that was thrown by the farmer, and he didn't know how it was growing, but he just knew it would, that kind of thing. Called a simile or a similitude. The others would be narrative parables. That is, they would be telling a story. And we're going to be looking at a subsection of that group this evening. Now, in looking at the parables, again, one of the things that I said in the beginning is that the parables of Jesus draw from things that would be commonly known. Unlike the parables that would have been used by the teachers of the day, the scribes, etc., they did not require a great deal of previous knowledge, a great deal of scriptural knowledge or traditional knowledge in order to understand understand them. And of course, that was Jesus' purpose, to open up in very, very simple but enlightening terms what God was doing. They also, and we'll see again, hopefully tonight, how the parables were addressed rather directly to people by sometimes by a question: which one of you, what man among you, would not? You remember the story of the lost sheep. Which one of you having on your sheep? So there's kind of a question, and some of the parables take that shape. It all comes down to a question, if you will, that Jesus poses by way of a parable to someone, again, to open them up to recognizing something about the action of God. Now, we looked at several groups of parables. Remember, as I said too, seemingly the primary way in which Jesus taught would be the use of parables. And so we can look, as we've been doing, at the message of Jesus as it has been conveyed or presented in parables. Now remember the first night, we looked at several parables that were meant to open us up to the love of God, the desire of God to forgive. Again, something in those parables, we found things that were extraordinary or wonderfully strange. For example, remember the story, the first parable we looked at, the man who was brought in before the king, and he owed 10,000 talents, which, as I explained at that time, was an enormous amount beyond any ability. It's almost like the national debt, okay? That would be what it would be. Remember, a talent would have been about 93 pounds of silver, and 10,000, we would say billions or zillions, you know, people say gazillions, meaning, well, they would use 10,000. So we use as much as, on one hand, the number was as great, but a talent was the largest way to measure. And the extraordinary thing was the king was, well, when a man asked him, begged him, to he forgave the debt. Again, the point was God's extraordinary desire, willingness, capacity to forgive. So often people don't think that. I was joking before about, about how many times in confession over the years I've run into people, and any priest you talk to will tell you this, they come in, people come in doubting God's desire to forgive or capacity to forgive. I mean, I've come up with the incredible sin that God can't forgive. Really? I'm that big? I'm bigger than God? Really? Yeah. But the message there was, look at this incredible, the people who have heard 10,000 talents. And he, I mean, as I said, he just wrote it off. Of course, then the second part of that was that when the man went out, he was expected to extend forgiveness to others. Yeah. Right? The second parable, again, kind of an extraordinary parable, kind of a quirky parable, is the story of the, it's sometimes called the workers in the vineyard. I like to call it the eccentric landowner. This is the story where the man went out in the morning and hired the workers, then went out 3 hours later, and went out, and went out, and went out. And then, which was itself, people would have listened to that and said, that's odd, you know, you normally figure out what you were going to do in the morning and hire the right amount of people. But he kept coming out and hiring people, and then at the very end he hired people with only an hour to work. And in paying them, he generously gave to those who came in last, he gave them a full day's wage. And even to this day, I love the parable because everybody sits there and goes, hey, but the first ones, they got stuck. You know, I mean, that's a nice word, but they got stuck. But again, as the man said, do you begrudge my generosity? The generosity, it makes you scratch your head. This is what God is like. This is what the grace of God is like. It's not earned. It's given freely. And it doesn't make a lot of sense to us because, you know, we think, well, that's not the way it should be. We're meant to step back and say, it's not a matter of the way it should be in my mind. Look at what this reveals about God and the generosity of God and the love of God. As I like to say, if you ever sing, will listen to somebody sing Amazing Grace. You take those words, the man who sang, wrote Amazing Grace, knew the meaning of that parable because he had been touched by the mercy of God. If you know the mercy of God, you know that parable. If you don't, well then, it's still a mystery. Then we looked at some parables about how, you know, again, to the mind of people that have been listening to Jesus, this isn't the way God works. Remember the 100 sheep losing one, the woman who lost the coin in the house, the man who lost both sons, not only the one who went away, but the one who stayed home and was far from his heart. In each case, the story spoke about the incredible desire, a crazy desire, a foolish desire from the human point of view, but the divine desire to embrace those who were lost. The Pharisees and scribes criticized Jesus because that's not the way God works. That's not the way God thinks. And Jesus told the story and said, no, this is indeed how God thinks. This is what God wants. This is what God desires. And so we looked at those parables, and then we looked at a few parables about, explicitly about, I mentioned a few a while ago, the mustard seed, the seed growing secretly, the leaven, as well as two parables about a man who found a treasure and a man who found a pearl of great price. Jesus explaining, saying about what the kingdom of God is like. It's already, as he was saying, it's already begun to break in. And he used those parables, the first couple, the mustard seed, the leaven, the seed growing secretly, to say, look at what you know. You know this. You don't understand how it's going to happen, but you know what's going to happen. Right? It's not a matter of trust. If you learn a lesson, if you will, from this, this is what is happening. Kingdom is breaking in and it is growing. And even if it's a small beginning, as Jesus might have been criticized, you're telling me the kingdom of God, this is the way God works. Here you got 12 guys who are out of work and you're walking around going, and this is how God's working? Huh? Mm-hmm. Look at the mustard seed. Look at this, the seed this is thrown in the ground. It always grows and it's always a harvest. Don't be scandalized by small beginnings. And then the two parables about the men whose lives were changed because they discovered one purely by chance, tripping over a treasure in a field, another working his whole life to find that pearl of great price. But when they found it, they realized that what they had before them, what they had come to discover, they gave everything in order to have it, in order to possess it, or be possessed by it. That's what the kingdom is like. And then we talked about some parables of wisdom. What is a, having said that about the kingdom, already begun but breaking in, we speak about, well, what does a wise disciple do? What does it mean to be a wise disciple? And over again, we found to be ready, to be prepared, to be aware of the moment, to recognize the moment, every moment we live is a moment of choice, a moment of decision, an important moment, and to seize upon it rather than to just let it go. And so that's where we have been so far. And I think just laying that out, you can see how so much themes that we are aware of in the teaching of Jesus, how they were embodied in those parables. Now, tonight, what we're going to look at first of all, four parables that are called parables of exemplary behavior. You'll find them on your sheets, the long sheets. It's basically a page. Yeah, it would be the third page, parables of exemplary behavior. these are narrative parables, stories, and we're familiar with them. Why they stand apart? From the time in late 19th, early 20th century, there was a famous scholar by the name of Adolf Willoughby. He was, of course, a German. And he studied parables. And he looked at these four parables, all found in Luke's gospel. And he said, these are a separate group because, as he said, they are examples of behavior. There's no comparison made. There's no interpretation, because he said no interpretation. It's just a why. This is what one should do or not do. Okay. Now, others have argued about it, but they are usually classified as a separate group. They are the Good Samaritan, the story of the rich fool, the story of the rich man and Lazarus, and the story of the Pharisee and the tax collector. Okay. All of those parables are found in Luke's gospel. Now, the structure of Luke's gospel, when you look at the parables and how they're laid out, what Luke has done in Mark and in Matthew following and in Luke, we find Jesus makes one journey to Jerusalem. In Mark and in Matthew, that journey to Jerusalem takes about two chapters. But what Luke has done is he has greatly extended it. He begins Jesus' journey to Jerusalem in chapter 9, verse 51, the end of chapter 9, and extends it into chapter 19. Much greater on. It is within this journey to Jerusalem, as he is on his way to Jerusalem and his disciples follow him, that we find so much of the teaching of Jesus presented. For example, while Matthew, while Jesus presents his disciples with what we call the Lord's Prayer in Matthew's Sermon on the Mount, Luke, who presents Jesus as so very often praying, as, and we'll pick up a parable following this, as Jesus is praying on the way, the disciples watch him and say, teach us to pray, because they have watched him pray. And so he teaches them, we have a section on prayer, right, that follows. Or again, we find a lot of the sayings and teachings of Jesus, for example, again in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew, we find it is kind of laced throughout Jesus' journey, as well as some of the parables. For example, the parables of the lost sheep, the lost coin, chapter 15 in the journey. The parable of the unjust steward. Remember, he got caught and he had to act quickly. Chapter 16. So much of the teachings of Jesus on to disciples we find in that extended journey to Jerusalem. The four parables that we'll look at tonight from these exemplary stories are all in that section. Okay, they're all in that section, which makes perfect sense because they're going to give us examples of how we should act and behave or think and how we shouldn't act, behave or think. Okay, so, and we're going to find also that some of the themes of Luke's gospel, of Jesus' appreciation, that Luke has underlined. And again, I would point out that way. The teachings of Jesus, Luke has placed a special emphasis on concern for the poor, those who are weak, those who are in need, and also warnings about the lure of wealth and how it can move one from discipleship. Okay, and so we find almost, if a person is wealthy, it's a negative in Luke's gospel. All except for Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus, and of course this isn't a parable, but Zacchaeus, the story of Zacchaeus, the little tax collector who goes out on a limb for Jesus. Sorry. Every once in a while I say that as he climbs the tree, you know. But and Danny DeVito is, you know, of course, Zacchaeus is a wealthy man, but when Zacchaeus speaks up, he gives half of what he gets to the poor. If anything is brought to his brother that isn't justly done, he repays more than the law requires him to. And Jesus says, today salvation has come to this house. The man has wealth, but he uses it in such a way that Jesus approves. You see? Now, so let's take a look at the parables today. The first one we're going to look at is the parable of the Good Samaritan. Now, this parable is the one parable in the Gospels where we find Jesus doing what the scribes did so often in their use of parables. What he does is he uses the parable to give an interpretation of a scripture text. Oftentimes, the scribes would use parables in arguing or discussing the scriptures, and they would use a parable to make a point. We don't find that in Jesus' parables, with the exception of the parable of the Good Samaritan. Now, the parable, and I'm going to read the introduction to the parable before I get to the parable itself. The parable is introduced by the note that the scribe is testing Jesus. He wants to test him, which normally means he wants to trip him up in some way. And he asks the question that would have been debated by scribes, and that is a question of the greatest commandment. What are the most important commandments? Because there were, according to scribal tradition, 613 commandments of the law. So you'd say, like, well, if there's a conflict, which one should I listen to? Which one should I do? You know, what should I do? Yeah. So, question about the greatest commandment. And so he raises the question. And so we read. Just then, a lawyer, a scribe, stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? He said to him, what is written in the law? What do you read there? He answered, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus said to him, you have given the right answer. Do this, and you will live. But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Now, let me just step back on that. What we have there is the combination, which we find in Mark and in Matthew, Jesus combining the commandments of the law. From Deuteronomy, the love of God, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and Leviticus, love of neighbor. In this case, what Luke has done is the scribe was asking a question. Jesus then asks him a question, which is the way scribes work. You ask a question, you get a question back, you know, and you go back and forth. So the man answers Jesus' question by combining Deuteronomy and Leviticus. And what Jesus says to him is, you answered correctly, do this. Now, the scribe is embarrassed. Better understand this. It's embarrassing in such a debate to ask a question when you know the answer. Okay? So by Jesus saying, you've answered rightly, go do it and live, he's embarrassed, the scribe. So the scribe, to justify himself, in other words, to justify the question, so I don't look like a complete idiot in front of the other scribes, he then goes, well, who is my neighbor? Who is my neighbor? Now, that's the question we start with, and that's the question which is spurs the parable itself. And Jesus replied, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. The road from Jerusalem to Jericho, there was a drop of like about 3,500 feet over a period of a distance of, say, 17 miles or so. But it was extraordinarily dangerous. In fact, the Essenes, the Dead Sea Scroll people, when they would travel that road, they would carry arms because they would have to defend themselves against robbers. So it was a very dangerous road. And so here is a man going down on his way, and he falls into this terrible fate. He is beaten, stripped, robbed, and left half dead. Okay, not dead, but half dead. Okay, now that will have a significance. Now, by chance, a priest was going down the road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. Now, if he was dead, not that this would be something you would applaud, but a man who, a corpse, if came in contact with a corpse, unless it was one's family member, would be unclean for a period of 7 days. And so some have argued, well, the priest who was going to Jerusalem saw him, thought he was dead, and didn't want to render himself unclean, so he walked on the other side. It doesn't say he was dead. He was half dead, okay? So, meaning that he was in terrible. So the man goes by without excuse. Now, then, so likewise a Levite. Now a Levite, the priests were of the tribe of Levi. The priests were, traced their heritage to Aaron, the brother of Moses, who was the high priest. Levites were others from the tribe of Levi, and they had, they assisted the priests and had roles within the cult. Okay, so again, kind of a sacred role that he would play. When he came to the place and saw him, he passed by on the other side. Now, again, just as you're thinking about this, the surprise comes next. Normally, a Jewish person hearing the story, you know, the rule of three, you tell a story in threes, a joke of three, who, you know, you never tell a joke with two people, it's always three, right? It's always the third guy is the part of the joke, you know? It's always like, it's not the priest and the rabbi, it's the priest, the minister, and the rabbi, you know, that kind of thing. So it's always that kind of thing. Well, now, with the priest, with the Levite, so now what are you expecting? You're expecting a layperson, right? As you're going along. But that's not what he said. Now, but a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. Now, the Samaritans and the Jews, we know, despised one another. The Samaritans had their roots in the Assyrian conquest of the Northern Kingdom, and what they, in the 8th century before the birth of Christ. And what they did was they, in order to break the spirit of people, was they would take them and deport them. And then they would take other people from lands they conquered and put them back there. The idea is, if you leave people in their own land, sooner or later, patriotic fervor will, and you'll have problems. But if you take them away and put them in a foreign land, you break their spirit, and they're not a problem. And so what the Assyrians did was they took the tribes off and they brought back Gentiles who were, and the people. And so we find here that the Samaritans were looked upon by the Jews as little better than the Gentiles who were despised. They themselves had no use for the Jews. They had a separate, they only accepted a particular redaction of the first 5 books of Moses, etc. They opposed when the rebuilding of the temple, when the exile was over, they tried to oppose that, and there was great bitterness. In fact, we can see in the story in John's Gospel of the woman at the well, who was a Samaritan, said, "You, a Jew, are talking to me, a Samaritan, you know, and, you know, oh, you want something, so now you're talking to me." So this, the idea of a Samaritan, the eyes would pop as you hear the story. We've heard it so often, we know. So this jolts them. Now, the Samaritan is moved with pity. And what does he do? He went to him. He didn't walk around him. He bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them, oil to soothe the pain and wine as a disinfectant. And then he put him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper and said, "Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend." He basically gives him enough to provide for him and his care for about a week or more. Okay. Now this is the Samaritan who's doing this. So as you're listening to this story, as you can imagine what the scribes who are sitting there are like, "Whoa, what?" And so what? The story doesn't end there. He said, I will repay you what you spent. End of the parable. Now, here's where Jesus, as I said, goes back to the text. He said, now, which of these do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? Now, notice what Jesus has done. He changes the question. The first question is, who is my neighbor? Which is to say, who is in, who's out? Okay, who is in that circle of people I must care for, and who are those who are outside? Neighbor was generally understood in terms of their own group. Okay, so they would normally think of neighbors as Jews and not Gentiles, etc. But Jesus changes the question. The question isn't, who is my neighbor? The question is, who acted as neighbor to the man who fell in with the robbers? Now, and he said, the one who showed him mercy. Notice he can't even say the Samaritan. Mm-hmm. Okay, he can't even get the word out of his mouth. The one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, go and do likewise. Okay. So the parable, from the point of view of an exemplary behavior, is not to ask the question about who is my neighbor, but to make sure you ask the question, am I neighbor to those who are in need? See the difference? See, he changes the question. We are not to ask who's in and who's out. We ought to ask, as the disciples of Jesus, right, have I been neighbor to the person who is in need? So you see, there's no comparison here to the kingdom of God, no reference, but it's an example of behavior. And so what we've got there is, you know, and of course, we're all going to school, and people would say, intelligence isn't having the answers to the questions, it's raising the right question, right? I never got credit for raising the right question, I only got credit for right answers, okay? So, but the point is, right? The right person is the one who asks the right question. Right? Christian, what is the question we should ask? What is the question I should ask? Okay, and so the first parable under this heading, exemplary story, the Good Samaritan, points out this is the question that we ought to ask. Now the second parable, which is right below it, is a parable that has been referred to as the parable of the rich fool. And that is because of the address of God to this man as the story goes on. Again, notice it's in Luke 12, so it's part of the journey narrative. Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly, and he thought to himself, and notice again, one of the things that Luke does is so often is he, in telling relating the parables of Jesus, he relates what's going on in the mind of one of the characters. Okay? For example, remember the prodigal son on his way home? What am I going to say? What am I going to say to Dad when I know what I'll say, right? We're in his mind. And here we have another example of this. And he thought to himself, what should I do? For I have no place to store my crops. Then he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones. And there I will store all my grain and all my goods. And I will say to myself, my soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry. But God said to him, you fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you. And the things you have prepared, where will they be? And so it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich toward God. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, one who stores up treasures of treasures in heaven, as opposed to the things that pass. Now, the interesting thing here is, if you go over that parable, you notice how many times the character in the parable speaks about I, my, me. How often the center there? Notice again, he has been very blessed, abundant. So what is he going to do? I am going to basically, again, secure myself. And this is one of the concerns of Luke, as I mentioned, where we find that the worry is that possessions, things we possess, can possess us. Apparently, Luke was writing for a community that had its roots in Paul's mission. And Paul, unlike Jesus, who was in the countryside, Paul went to cities, right? That's why we have the letter to the Thessalonians and the Corinthians. And he would go to the cities and he would work there as a tent maker. He would work with canvas, basically, is what he would do. And he would get involved with the guilds there, and then he would begin to preach, etc. But the point is that the church of Luke, we don't know exactly where it is in any way, shape, or form, except that it clearly is a church of a Pauline mission. And so it's an urban church. And therefore, his concern, perhaps because of what he has seen, and one of the things he underlines, is how people like ourselves, basically middle-class people trying to get ahead, how we can get caught up in trying to secure ourselves with the things that we own. They can, in a sense, own us. And so this man decides he's in charge of his life, right? I'm going to secure myself. I'm going to build bigger bonds. Eat, drink, relax. I remember a couple of years ago, there was a television commercial, and I said, this is the rich fool for the 21st century. And I said, the guy is sitting, you might remember this, the guy is sitting there in bed with his laptop. And he starts telling us that this is great. I can get right in here, I can trade here, I can do this, I got everything. Everything's all set. I'm set. I'm going to bed. I said, this is the rich fool. He's sitting there with his laptop thinking he's secured himself. He secured his future. He's in charge. This is an example of something we should not be. Okay. Rather, and within the context of the gospel, Jesus tells the parable because while he's going along, a dispute is brought to his attention. Someone wants his judgment on the dispute about an inheritance. Okay, and Jesus will have no part of it. But they were all caught up about the money, the inheritance, etc. And he tells the parable in response to that. Okay, and so notice the word "you fool." Now, fool is one who is so ignorant that they do not know God. In fact, Psalm 14:1 starts, "The fool says in his or her heart, okay, there is no God above." The fool says there is no God. They're so profoundly ignorant of the way things are, they don't recognize. This man, as we look at the parable, and again, this is one of those parables that takes a bit of interpretation. Why is he called a fool? He thinks he's in charge of his own life. He tries to secure himself by his possessions. He thinks he's only one, maybe all. There's a lesson there to be learned, because we can think we're in charge, right? And what we have to do is learn over again, we're not. We're not. And so here, as Jesus gives this parable, again, a lesson for disciples who would follow him. Okay? Don't be like this man who, again, notice, no thought of God, no thought of it. My future, my, and I'm going to secure myself. Eat, drink, and be merry. Good night. Good night. But we're not in control of our lives. So again, like keeping Zacchaeus in mind, how do I use the things I've been blessed with? And again, what is the way I should use them to be in line with God? This man is a fool because he has no inkling into God. He's so profoundly ignorant he thinks he's in trouble. Okay. So it's called the parable of the rich man. Now, next parable also deals with a wealthy man. And one of the great things about this parable is what it doesn't say and what we supply. And this is the parable of the rich man and Lazarus. Now, again, I will start reading the parable and break into different points. There was a rich man, again, notice chapter 16. So, again, within this, there was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and who feasted sumptuously every day. Purple, of course, was a color that was associated with great wealth, okay? And so he's described as a very wealthy man who was very blessed with he feasted sumptuously every day. The other side, at his gate lay a poor man named Lazarus. This is the only parable, by the way, that a character has a name. Okay, this is the only parable where a character is named. Okay, so rich man named Lazarus. Okay, poor man named Lazarus. Covered with sores. So see him as someone who is different kinds of illnesses, and of course in those days medicine, so a person would be on the street, and so he longed to satisfy his hunger with what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs would come and lick his sores. Now these aren't dogs like we have at home. These are the wild dogs of the street. Okay, so they're coming up and kind of licking, nipping at him like food, you know. So this is the picture of him. He's not there with a pet. Okay, these are the wild dogs that would run in the street. The poor man died and was carried away by the angels to be with Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried. Notice, station being brought up to the bosom of Abraham, salvation. The other man was buried. Okay, so we have a contrast there. In Hades, okay, the place of the Greek way of speaking of Sheol, the place of the dead, where he was being tormented, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. He called out, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in agony in these flames." Now notice the arrogance of this, okay? You're in hell and you're giving orders to Abraham, okay? Send Lazarus, notice he knows his name. Notice he knows his name. This is what I meant before. We don't hear that he did anything to deny him, but we all have our picture in the mind. If he's at his gate, he walked by him every day. It doesn't say that though. We supply the picture, don't we? We supply the picture. He knows the man's name because he's able to call out to Abraham. And but Abraham said, "Child, remember that during your lifetime you received good things, and Lazarus in like manner evil things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. Besides all this, between you and us, a great chasm has been fixed, so that those who might want to pass from here to you cannot do so, and no one can cross from there to us." Now, so we have this picture of this distance, and again, the character of the rich man. Again, we see somebody with wealth, sumptuous, eating sumptuously, luxury, etc. And again, apparently, he knew the man, which challenges us. It's not like he walked over and kicked Lazarus. It's not like he sat there and said, "Boy, this is good," and walked away. All right? It's nothing, we know nothing about it, but we put it on minds. He must have known he was there. Which challenges me and you to think about the people we look at but don't see, you know, and we can walk by. Now, and he said to him, "Father, I beg you to send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may warn them, so that they will not also come into this place of torment." Abraham replied, they have Moses and the prophets. They should listen to them. Now, the point being, Moses and the prophets, right, he wants Lazarus to go to warn his brothers so he doesn't find the same. The point, what Abraham is saying is, if they know Moses, the law, if they know the prophets, that's all they need. That's all they need. It is right there. It is right there. Concern for the poor, for the needy, for the afflicted, for the weak, for the... It's right there. If they haven't read that, and he goes on, and here's an interesting point I'll mention to you. All right. And he said, yes, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent. And Abraham said to him, if they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead. Now, here's an interesting crossover. Where also do you know of a Lazarus? Martha and Mary. And Lazarus was raised from the dead. Now, in John's Gospel, I guess I'll get ahead of myself a little bit here. Next week, in the Gospel, we hear the story from John of the cleansing of the temple, where Jesus drives out the money changers and the animals and everything else. What is interesting is that in John's Gospel, that story is in chapter 2, right in the beginning of the Gospel. First time Jesus goes up for Passover into Jerusalem. In Mark and Matthew and Luke, as I've said, Jesus only goes to Jerusalem once at the end of his life. Right? Mm-hmm. And therefore, the cleansing of the temple takes place just before. In fact, it seems to be the spur that just said, we've had enough of this guy, we're going to have to, you know, he's become a problem, so now we're going to have to deal with it. Okay. Which perhaps is more accurate historically, that event. John has Jesus go up to Jerusalem several times during his ministry, which is probably also more accurate than the synoptics, okay? But here's what John does. What John does is he takes the story of Lazarus and he makes it the last of the seven signs in the book of signs in the first part of the gospel. And when Lazarus is raised from the dead, okay, and he comes out of the tomb, the next thing we hear of is how Caiaphas and the authorities have gathered because the people have started to come out there because they've come to believe in him because of Lazarus. And what John has done is the greatest of Jesus' signs, where he gives life from death, ironically, is the reason why those his enemies try to put him to death. Okay. Therefore, what scholars will get back and forth is, okay, he says here, they will not believe even if someone comes back from the dead. With an eye toward John, the reason when the man came back from the dead, Lazarus came back from the dead, that was the spur in John to move to kill Jesus. Okay, so you see how this the interesting kind of twist over. Okay, they will not listen even if someone comes back from the dead. Okay, and John, because what John has done is he's moved the stories around so that the drama of the greatest sign is now the trigger that leads to the plot to kill Jesus. Okay? The man was raised from the dead, and they not only didn't believe, but it moved to try and destroy him. So scholars have argued, and back and forth, because there are different places where there are interesting parallels, if you will, broadly speaking, between Luke and John. You know, whether or not that last comment was inspired by the tradition that John has, or not. So it's a kind of an interest. Well, you know, it, it, it's not gonna keep you up tonight, okay? But I spent some of my time teaching this stuff, so every once in a while I just have to throw it out there. And I see from the looks on your faces like, the same thing I had when I used to teach, at the seminary. A funny thing I said to people when I was teaching in the other parish and here, I said, you know, when I was teaching in the parish, I saw something there I had never seen before. And one of my former students who I was talking to said to me, well, what was that? And I said, interest. He didn't really appreciate that much, but I honestly didn't care. So we got along very well. But it's interesting there. But here again, I like this parable because what it does is I realize I'm so engaged in it, I'm filling in the blanks. I'm filling in the picture. I know what he did because I know what I do. He walked by and didn't do anything. To my great shame, I tell a story. And when I was going to school in the city, I had to take courses, one course I had to take up down in General Theological Seminary, which was off, I can't think of the name, 8th and 9th Avenue off 23rd Street. So I got off the 7th train, 23rd. And I was walking up, and there was a big Y that was there, and all along the side you had people sitting on the street, and they had big cardboard boxes that you would get out for refrigerators and this kind of stuff. And they were sitting there, and some of them were, you know, drugs, some of them were just like reaching out. And I remember walking by the first couple of times, and I just didn't know what to do. I was kind of shocked. You know, I just didn't know what, you know, looking at this and what to do. But then, a couple of weeks later, I noticed something. I didn't see them anymore. They hadn't gone anywhere. I just didn't see them anymore. You know, we can train ourselves, and we can say, oh, it's a defense mechanism. Yeah, well, maybe. It's true, to a certain extent. We got to fight against that defense mechanism so we don't overlook who's in front of us. And say, well, you know, I can't look at this. It's too much for me. Too much for you? What do you think it is for him? So, you know, whenever I see this parable, I think of those incidents, and how easily can block off. And I picture him walking by. I picture him in his carriage going by with Lazarus there and just not seeing him. Right? And I think everybody who hears the story and is following it would do the same thing. He knew he was there, but he just went by. That's something that, again, we can't. So, if the rich fool relied upon himself and his wealth to secure himself, right, now we have a parable that shows us that we, if we follow the scriptures, Moses and the prophets, we recognize what we should do is reach out using what we've got for those who are in need. Now, the final parable in this grouping is on and this is the parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector. Notice it's up there in Luke 18. And this is the only parable where a Pharisee is a character in the story. Okay, here's the only parable. So, and again, the shock here, excuse me, tax collector, publican, etc. They were, as we know, they were despised. You know, they collected tolls from their own people. They were in the employ of the Romans, and so they looked at them as preying on their own people, as collaborators, and all different kinds of things. They were unclean, etc. So, now, the shock here is that as we go into the scene of the parable of the temple, this man goes into the temple. This would have been something that would have been, again, very striking to those who would have heard it. Probably, as someone suggests, the parable might have been directed to Pharisees. And so for the Pharisees to hear a tax collector going into the temple, that would have, again, popped their eyes open the same way earlier on a Samaritan, you know, would have done this. So now, Jesus tells us, two men went up to the temple to pray. One, a Pharisee, and the other, a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, was praying thus. Now, standing was the posture of prayer. So don't contrast it with us kneeling, okay? The posture of prayer was to be standing, okay? So, now, but what does he say? He was praying thus, God, I thank you that I am not like other people, thieves, rogues, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. Right? Now, interestingly, the translation here is he prayed by himself, standing by himself, praying by himself. Some have translated it's almost like praying to himself. But he's praying by himself, and notice what he's done. He gives thanks to God because God's done a good job. Yeah, okay. You know, it's almost like, you know, you're lucky, God, look at what you've done. You know, I am indeed a magnificent specimen. No, I'm talking about the parable, not the speaker.
No, we got that.
I'm not like thieves, rogues, adulterers, or even this tax collector looking over, okay? And then he says, and this is again, something that is beyond what would be expected. I fast twice a week. Now, a fast would be food and water. Now, remember where you are. You're in Palestine here, okay? The law required a man to fast one day a year, and that was the Feast of Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. So, Pharisees would fast. This Pharisee saying, I fast twice a week. It's a very pious practice, fasting twice a week. And then he said, I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of all my income. So he is talking about the things that he does. He is presenting himself before God, acknowledging his importance, his greatness, right? Goodness. But the tax collector, standing far off, so you get the picture of the Pharisee up and the tax collector, the distant, almost like against the back wall, if you will. And he would not even look up to heaven, but was beating his breast and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Now here is what would have jolted the Pharisees. I tell you, this man went down to his home justified rather than the other one. Now, justified, made righteous. In other words, he was in right relationship with God. Not the other one. The tax collector was justified, not by what he did, but by God, because he recognizes his sinfulness, he asks for God's mercy. Placing himself, trusting in God, recognizing his total need for God, his total failure, his weakness. You know, again, remember what we've been seeing. God embraces. He didn't earn it. But the Pharisee, on the other hand, he's busy talking about all of his merits, all of the things he has done, which might be rather extraordinary in what he's done. But again, he doesn't ask God for anything. He doesn't seem to have any need for anything except a place to go and Lord himself. And so here again, how are you to act? How are you to act as a disciple? How am I to act as a disciple? To recognize my weakness, to recognize my need, to place myself totally recognizing that, totally, I have no leg to stand on. That's what Paul says in the first part of Romans, in the first four chapters. He's saying, both Jews who have the law and Greeks, the Gentiles who don't, all have sinned. Therefore, no one has a claim on God's grace. All are completely dependent upon God. The beginning of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus begins the Beatitudes by saying, blessed are the poor in spirit. Not the poor, but the poor in spirit. One who recognizes their total dependence upon God. Complete dependence upon God and places him or herself That doesn't mean you don't do anything. I think it was the first person I ever heard, not that I heard personally, but was attributed to him, to me, was John the 23rd, with the idea of work like everything depends on you, but pray because everything does depend on God. Yeah. And that was, again, that is, I am totally weak. Interestingly enough, when you look at, I've often thought about this with the 12-step programs. Yeah. First step is I'm powerless over whatever it is, alcohol, drugs, gambling, or whatever it is. My life is out of control. It isn't my control. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Basically, the Beatitudes can be in a sense of being integrated into that. Okay. Because I have no control. It's all in your hands. And I give it to you. This man said, I have sinned. He trusts and he goes back. He is made literally righteous, put in right relationship with God. That's not because of our effort, not because of what we have done, okay? But rather to accept the gift. That's the posture of disciples, not the Pharisee. I'll certainly fast twice a week. Certainly give to the poor. Certainly give what you have. But recognize when it's all said and done, I am totally dependent upon God's grace. Okay? Totally dependent upon that. Okay? So those four parables, okay, those four parables are called parables that are of illustrations or exemplary stories. Do you see what I'm saying? Did it make sense to you as I explained them tonight?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. All right. So when you come across these parables and you think about them a little bit, you know, again, it's I find they present a challenge. Okay, remember the parables were used also not only to reveal what God is like, but also what God expects of us. Okay, what is the right question? Do I always ask the right question? Do I keep my eyes open to those who are in need? Okay? Even when there might not be desirable, when there might not be a camel around, when a person might, you know, be difficult to do. Do I try? Or do I walk away and say, I tried? Do I trust in God? Or do I try to build and secure myself? And I'm sort of an insomniac. So I will sit there at times and watch late night television, which is, if that doesn't kill you, I don't know. But, you know, in the commercials, you know, you can secure yourself. You know, you can do this. You can be happy ever. You can say, first of all, you'll have no wrinkles. Okay? Your hair will grow back. That captures my interest. You can secure yourself. You can secure yourself for many years to come. Yeah. Right? Sound familiar? Yeah. Sound familiar? All this stuff. This is what we're sending out over and again. This is the message. Right? I earned it. I did this. See what works against the message of Jesus, the message of the gospel. Okay? And so the parables, those particular parables, now others, of course, as we've seen, examples of how we should behave, but these in particular are that separate group exemplary stories. Now, what I want to do in the time we have left is to take a look at another group of parables. These are under what's called the parables of life before God. And I'll see if I can find it. Okay, so first one we're going to look at is on Roman numeral page 7. Okay. Now, these are parables which, again, a variety of things. We'll take a look at them again next week. But they are, again, as it living before, how should we do this? You know, or living. It gives warnings, it gives exhortation, it's meant to give comfort. So it's really a wide umbrella. Okay, now, what I wanted to do tonight is look at two parables, well, actually a couple of parables, two of them are twin parables, about prayer. Okay, again, how we are to pray. Now, remember before I said in Luke's gospel, in the beginning of chapter 11, Jesus is sitting by the road and with the disciples together, and they're watching Jesus pray. And when Jesus has finished praying, the disciples come to him and they say, "Teach us to pray as John taught his disciples to pray." And so it's at that point that in Luke's gospel, we find Jesus instructing his disciples with the prayer and the form of the prayer in Luke, we call the Lord's Prayer. The two forms of the prayer are similarities and differences. Each one is perhaps has characteristics that are a little bit more original than the other. Maybe one night I'll do a talk on the two forms of the Lord's Prayer. But anyhow, Jesus gives the prayer to him. Now, following that, we have Jesus speaking now about questions. Once I tell you how to pray or what to say, now how do I go about praying? And so look at the letter E on the sheet. It's notice Luke 11, 5 to 8. Remember I said 1 to 4 is the introduction and the prayer. Now, 11, 5 to 8. And he said to them, suppose one of you, again, notice how he engages. Put yourself in this position. Okay, suppose one of you has a friend, and you go to him at midnight and say to him, "Friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread, for a friend of mine has arrived, and I have nothing to set before him." Now, that might sound a little strange at midnight that somebody would show up. Mm-hmm. But remember, people would travel when it was cooler. Okay, so they would come. And so it wasn't quite as strange as it is to our ears. So someone has come, and he's surprised. And so he goes to his friend, and he answers from within, "Go away. Do not bother me. The door has already been locked, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot go and give you anything." Okay. Now remember again, this would be the kind of a house that would be not large, so to move, you'd be tripping over each other, etc. So, right? But I tell you that even though he will not get up and give him anything because he is a friend, at least because of his persistence, he will get up and give him what he needs. Now, understand this. The story is told not because the man inside is to be seen, you know, that you're knocking on his door. He is not to be seen as cipher for God. Okay. Rather, this parable works in the idea of from a lesser to a greater, meaning this. If in this situation, even in this situation, this man will get up because you're such a pest, okay, all right? Now, he will get up and give you what you want. How much more will your Father in heaven give to those who ask? Okay, so God is not being compared with the man inside. But he was saying, recognizing, again, in this world, the importance of hospitality. Okay, if someone came to your house, you were expected to provide for them, right? And you come, and the man is almost shameless in the fact that he comes and he's not going to take no for an answer. And finally, inside, you know, he relents, "Here, go away, go away." You know, God is not like that, all right? But the point is, if this man, and all their weaknesses, will get up and give him what he needs, right? Because he is shamelessly coming after him, how much more will God, who is not weak, who is not imperfect, but is perfect, give to his children who ask? So when you pray, pray trusting that you will be heard. Okay, trusting that you will be heard. Okay, and the parable works different ways. They would argue, and certainly from a lesser situation, if it's true in this case, it'll be true in the greater case. Conversely, you find where argument is, if it's in the greater case, it'll be true in the lesser case. But here, the parable is, if this man inside, and if you're sitting there saying, which one of you, you can say, well, but, you know, it's your friend, you should get up. So the person inside is not exactly being viewed as, you know, being put upon here. So he should get up, but if he doesn't, right, he will get up because of the persistence. Well, how much more, right, will God? You don't have to worry about, I don't have to go praying and wearing down God the way this guy has to wear him down inside. I'm not going away, you know, right, I'm not going away. What song do your kids like to hear? You know, I'm that kind of, right. Now, a parable that is very much like it is on the next page. And this is sometimes called a twin parable. This is the story of a widow and a wicked judge. Remember the story? Right. Now, there's a kind of a humor in this too. Sometimes we don't think of Jesus as having a sense of humor. But let me see. He said, in a certain city there was a judge who neither feared God nor had respect for people. Now, that's about as low as you can let it go, okay? He has a fear of God, so remember when we talk about the fool says in his heart there is no God above, no respect for God, and no respect for people, has no use for anybody, anything, etc. So this is a despicable human being, okay? Now, so, in that city there was a widow who kept coming to him and saying, grant me justice against my opponent. For a while, he refused, like the guy inside the house, right? Saying, go away, you know, right? But later he said to himself, though I have no fear, now notice again, Luke, okay, with the mindset. Though I have no fear, he knows it himself, though I have no fear of God, no respect for anyone, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will grant her justice, so that she may not wear me out by constantly coming. Literally, that's not what it says. Literally, it says that she might give me a black eye. Okay. So if you have this picture, which is kind of humorous to me, you have this little widow with a cane, and the judge is saying, she's gonna clock me one if I don't give her what she wants. You know, she got this, I'm not going away. Okay. So that's literally what it says. She'll give me a black eye, you know, which of course you can see where they translate a little differently. Will not, now here's the question. Now, the Lord said, listen to what the unjust judge said. Okay? Will not God grant justice to his chosen ones and who cry out to him day and night? Will he delay long in helping them? I tell you, he will quickly grant justice to them. And yet when the Son of Man comes, will he find such faith on earth? So again, you have, obviously, God is not the unjust judge, okay? The unjust judge distances himself as much as you possibly can, draping himself in the colors of demonic, really. I have no use for God, no use for anybody, etc. But listen to what he said. This man will ultimately give in because the woman does not give up. Will God not give to his children, God who is perfect, God who is loving, will he not give to his children what they ask for? But when the Son of Man comes, as he said, will he find such faith? Faith among people that they trust in God that way when they pray? So, you have these two parables, and they're called, like, remember as I said last time, the parable of the mustard seed and the parable of the leaven are sometimes called twin parables, and they are, in their case, they put one after the other. These parables are separated, but you can see if they're put together, same situation. same situation. What might seem at first like my prayer isn't heard, don't doubt that it's heard. Don't doubt. You know, sometimes I might have even said this here, that sometimes when we pray, it's not that we pray so much as we're submitting a work order. You know, I want this here, I want it in blue, I want it quickly, and if I don't get it, I'm going someplace else. I will not believe in you, right? Ever hear anything like that? And basically, but so often, we all know, we pray, and sometimes you say, I don't hear anything. You know, doesn't seem. Do you doubt when you pray? Look at these cases. At first, it seemed like they were not going to be heard. But if these imperfect and completely corrupt individuals, well, how much more God? How much more God will give you? But remember, it's God's gift. God answers. God answers. But that doesn't mean God jumps to my tune or my sense of timing. Right? Again, something that is very hard to learn. Now, the next two parables deal with that a little bit more. These are, going back to the other page, we flip back, okay? This parable is called God's Good Gifts. And you'll notice this is F, okay? You'll notice it's in Matthew, and you'll notice it's in Luke. Matthew, notice 7, 9 to 11. It's the Sermon on the Mount. Matthew 5, 6, and 7, that's the Sermon on the Mount. Okay. Luke, okay, his form is in chapter 11 on the way to Jerusalem. Okay, so you see they're placed in different ways. Matthew, just as an aside, Matthew is a builder. Okay. Matthew likes to construct sermons. There are five great sermons in Matthew's gospel. In fact, when you open most commentaries, certainly all the commentaries on Matthew's gospel, you will find the outline of the gospel. And of course, the outline isn't something Matthew gave us. It's the outline that we look at the gospel and outline it, is centered around these five great sermons. And what we find is there is a section of Jesus' ministry followed by a sermon, followed by a section of the ministry, followed by a sermon. And so we start with the Sermon on the Mount. Then, after that, Jesus begins, we have a ministry of miracles and calls, followed by a sermon that's called the ministry sermon, where Jesus speaks about the mission of the disciples to go out, followed by a section where Jesus begins to experience rejection, followed by a discourse made up of parables, chapter 13, followed by then the ministry going on, and ultimately the fourth discourse is the parable, is the discourse of the church life, in other words, how we ought to live with one another. So the first parable we looked at is the very last part of that. Okay, and then finally the final parable, as Jesus goes to Jerusalem, and then just before the passion narrative, he gathers his disciples and looks ahead to the final times. And so we found the parable there of the 10 bridesmaids, okay, looking ahead to the time. But those five parables, what we find is Matthew takes the teaching of Jesus and he places it together so we have parables. See, probably Matthew was not a tax collector. Matthew was more likely a converted scribe, okay? He was more likely a converted scribe. At the end of chapter 13, he speaks about a scribe who's trained for the kingdom of heaven, one who brings forth from his storehouse both the new and the old. The new is given the prominent position. Normally it's the old and the new, with the old taking precedent. We go back and say, well, what have we always done? No. Now, in the light of what has happened in Jesus, everything that is old is seen through what Jesus tells us. I have not come to abolish the law and the prophets. I have come to fulfill them. And and so they find their fulfillment in you. So many think that Matthew, the one who gives us the, not the tax collector of the 12, but the one who is responsible for the first gospel, is a converted scribe, therefore a teacher. Okay? And he likes to build sermons. Luke, on the other hand, Luke tends, from what we can see, to keep the sources, the traditions, he gets separate. Okay, and so we will find as we look through the gospel, he doesn't build great sermons, but rather he will take the material, like the prayer material, and he will place it in the context of the journey to Jerusalem. Okay, teaching, but in his own way. So we'll find different, like for example here, Matthew in chapter 7, Sermon on the Mount, is in Luke chapter 11. Okay, now with that aside, we'll read Matthew first, because they're very similar. Is there anyone among you who, if your child asks for bread, would give him a stone? Or if a child asks for a fish, would give him a snake? Now, understand this. Bread didn't come in bags for the crystal, okay? Bread looked kind of like a stone. And when he is talking there as well about fish, there's a fish called a barbel. And it looks like a serpent. Okay. The idea is they look similar. Okay. Now, if a child asks for a fish, would he give him a snake? Right. If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good things to those who ask him? Okay. Answers a question, doesn't it? Why didn't I get what I asked for? Why didn't I get what I wanted? Well, maybe what I wanted was a rock. You know, I thought it was bread, but it was a rock. But God gave me something else. I thought it was a fish, but it was a snake. God gave me something else. I mean, parents, right? Most of you have been parents, or when you were kids, we were all kids, we all had that experience. Right? Did you ever have that experience of wanting something that your parents said, no, you can't have it, it's not good for you? Yeah. And you said, you don't love me. Right? Yeah. You don't love me. And then, as you get a little bit older, you say, you know, if I had gotten that, that would not have been good. You know? But you don't love me. Why can't I have chocolate for supper? No. You know, now today, as my teeth are rotting out, I see the wisdom in my eyes. Your parent is not going to give you something that's going to hurt you. And sometimes it takes humility to realize that what I think I know is not the best of all worlds. Okay? We tend to think, I know best. And so here, Jesus teaches his disciples, when you pray, pray, Father. This is obviously Abba, with a childlike trust. And when you pray, okay, don't be put off because the answer isn't there right away. Think that God is not going to hear his children. And if you don't get what you want as you want it, don't think that God is doing that. God will not hurt you. In fact, maybe I don't understand it, but you trust that what I receive, right, it might not be what I wanted, I might never really appreciate it, but in fact, I trust that it was better for me than what I wanted. So you see what he's teaching about prayer? Isn't that something we all have to learn over and over and over again? And I can't tell you how many times, if I had gotten what I wanted, I mean, it wouldn't have been good. It wouldn't have been good. You might think of that yourselves. In the same way, we find, and see, this shows you how Luke's form of it. Is there anyone among you whose child asks for a fish, we'll give him a snake instead of a fish? Or if a child asks for an egg, we'll give him a scorpion. An egg, a scorpion will roll itself up, like, look like an egg. So, do you think what I got, do you think God is going to give you, you want an A, what you got? Do you think he gave you a scorpion? You didn't get what you wanted exactly as you wanted it? But what you got, do you think he's going to hurt you? Now, sometimes that can be very difficult for us. And it can be very painful at times when we don't get what we have set our hearts on, what we think we know is best. But that, again, is part of what it means to be poor in spirit. To trust. I don't have control of everything. I don't know, believe it or not, all things. I haven't got the ability, to see what is best. I have my ideas. I present them to the Lord, but then I trust. I have to trust that he knows best. Doesn't mean I'm going to have answers. There's no promise here that you're going to get a sheet giving you all the explanation. That's not what is promised. What is promised is, look, you know from your experience, and you know how weak you are. You know how weak you are. I know how sinful I am. I know how rotten I can be. But if my nephew or niece needed something, I would move heaven and hell to make sure they got what was really, truly good for them. Now, if I, who am as sinful as that, would do that for, how is God, who is not sinful, but who is perfect, who has perfect love for me, would do anything of it? But I have to trust. And that can be very difficult to do. But when you pray, pray with the trust that you will be heard. And if I don't get what I want as I wanted it, if my work order doesn't come through, okay? Don't think God hasn't heard. Don't think God hasn't cared. Quite the opposite. God cares enough. He's not going to give you what you want if it will hurt you or keep you from what is truly good. That is how disciples are to pray. Okay. So, with that in mind, let us just pray that God will bless us all this evening on our way home and continue to bless us through the remainder of the Lent. May Almighty God bless all of you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Okay, so listen, I see you next week. I take a count each week. How many do I lose here?